Start by going by together in 1936 in Grafton.
Who was that?
That was Talbot Jenkins.
Talbot Jenkins?
And he was smarter than I was. I stayed on Cookie Inn, but he quit and went back to school, I think. Got an education. Well, I stayed on Cookie Inn because I thought I could get a lot more to eat there. But I drove horses. I worked in that camp until January, I think it was, in 1937. And that was the winter that there wasn't any snow, but we were real late, and they couldn't move any wood. And Marsh Hastings is one of his camps in Grafton. And he went through bankruptcy, I guess. He gave it up, the company took it over, and they laid off most all of our men. I was out of a job for about a week. My father was working at Sunday Cove. He fell and broke his kneecap. He could drive the horses for Leslie Davis. And Leslie Davis come and got me to go up and drive that team the rest of the winter. Things had to be kept clean.
And the river drivers, the cookie, didn't he have to deliver food to the river drivers?
Yeah, I cookied on the drive in Grafton. Well, I went on to work on the river, but they needed a cookie, and they knew I had the cookie before, so I went to cookie in for a while. And then we got up at 3:30 in the morning. The crew had to be out way before daylight on the river. And then they had 4 meals a day. You had a breakfast, and you had 9, 10 o'clock or so that we had to lug them out to lunch. And then again in the afternoon, 2 or 3 o'clock, and then they come back to camp at night for their night meal. It was a long day. That was in Grafton. That was what they call the old Pauper's Air Camp, and that's really the only camp that they ever could tank them up to bed.
Can you tell us more about that one?
I'll let Avery tell that one.
Okay. Tom, what's your favorite part of woods work?
I think falling is the most fun. But I can tell you, after I got out of college, I hated that flatland country and I couldn't wait. saddest tree I ever fell was right in an opening. And it was a double red maple. And I had a little home light saw that was just the most powerful damn thing you ever saw. And nobody liked it because it kicked. It kicked when you started it. And they saw it. For some reason or other, they decided they wanted that tree out of there, so I was going to fall it. I said, I'm not. Instead of falling one side and then the other, I tried to fall them both together. And I cut the wrong side off first and come down and smash that saw. And he said, I thought that.
Dick, what's your favorite woods operations?
Oh, I think I like to drive the buses the best of anything.
Yeah.
A good team, and I think when we used to cut pine clear, like you used to, and cut blooded and roll down the scoop, I think that probably driving the scoop team, I enjoy doing most of anything.
Now, be sure everyone knows what a school is, but I'll tell you, in case anybody doesn't know what a school is, I think the biggest people know what a school is, so.
Well, it's a long sled, two runners, a bunk about 8 feet on center, and a nose about 30 inches to 3 feet. It's got these two bunks on it, you have stakes on it, and of course you have to have a wrap chain to wrap it. If it's good flat ground on summertime, why, you don't use any pole in it. And it comes a little snow or down here, you have to put a pole in it. Otherwise, not on much flat ground, but if you've got a good man to love you, it's kind of fun. Especially when I have my brother on me, we can both load the log, it was awful easy.
Avery, what's your favorite pile of woods operation?
Most of my No, I trapped the Bruce Bailey one, and then he plowed the night home. Some, but there was always a group that that seemed to be together that done the play, and, you know, lots of times it wasn't enough to make up another round or something, so I didn't play a lot, I did some.
Do you any whittling or anything like that?
No.
No?
I hate myself most of the time.
I do remember
chainsaws by that time, the guy's sawing in, and he just saw the tree down on the yard. And I went up to the top of it where he cut it off to measure it. And the saw was run, I wasn't paying attention to that. He was really hollering at me, and I turned around and looked at him, and he said, "Look." I looked up, and there was a sugar maple about that big coming down. So I just fell over. Luckily, we had about 4 feet of snow. I just went over backwards into the snow, and right where that thing hit, right where I was standing.
Wow. Ernest?
Well, I guess one of the things that I remember really, really isn't anything that happened to me, but we were working in comparison to the medical service that we had today from what it was then. We were working across the river from, up on the Rapid River, across the river from Cedar Stump for Leslie Davis and Walter Blake. That was E.G. Blake's father, was driving a team up there, and about 8 o'clock one morning, the log rolled and hit him in the leg, and broke his leg right off. And Davis, Lester Davis was there, and he put a board on it, and he set it first, pulled it into place, set it, put a board on it, and wrapped it up. Took a forward sled, which is a drag sled, that's a sled that they use to drag logs, to a pair of horses and drag logs out on. They put some boards on that, on one of the old hobble doors, I guess it was. And laid some of the camp blankets on it, loaded him onto that. It was 8 miles to Upton, up through the woods over the Tocco. Hauled him off there with a set of sleds. Leslie Davis had an old Model A Ford. It was a roadster, I guess they called it. It had the camp was stopped, you know, the rumble seat. You know. Loaded him into that, and at 8 o'clock that night, they landed him in Lewiston Hospital. Today, they'd had him there in 20 minutes for the helicopter. But that, I always remember that.
Did his leg...
Oh, yeah, it healed up. I don't know if he ever went down anymore, because he was an old man then.
Yeah, yeah. Sure.
I don't know if he ever went back to work.
He was 70-some years old. There was some young fellows shipped in there on Saturday, and they still had a little echo with them. They got pretty mousy. He told them, "Shut up." One of them jumped up and hit the old fellow, gave him a black eye, but he tackled him, pushed him in over the deacon seat between the bunks, got him to the throat. I guess he'd killed him, then pulled him off. He was 70-some years old. He's fighting now.
Avery, you have a special character you remember?
In the spring of 1936, after the 36 strike, I worked on the
always carried his little spot next to him. It was so just, he wasn't down to my size.
Tell us about the time somebody did some damage to that. That was a good story. I didn't about it falling out the floor. Tom, anything?
I don't know long ago.
Ernest?
Yeah. I hated the camp dog in the virtual.
Same thing.
Okay. That's pretty much agreement there. Next question is, do we have any stories about horses or men or equipment that particularly interesting? Finally, got any stories about horses? Or?
Yeah, I did. A story about two horses.
Two horses, okay.
I'm going to get time. When I was in high school, we got firewood on London, and we had one horse that was supposed to be a dragon horse, but all purpose horses, which is. I came down at one place I put rider chain on, and late afternoon I went and put it on, and it was frozen in the link, you know, so it was, but I slammed it down on the wood. When he did, he took off. Well, I thought the stake that it went by, and went up and got all the rain, but there's no holding, no stopping, you know. When we went down over this last hill, and there was a bit of a corner, chap corner, and I knew he couldn't do it, so I put him right out in the snow. And then I had to run over the wood and turn him around and load it back on. And then I had another horse, a very good horse, but I was hauling the log with one sled, and I had a sighting plate, and I tipped over and did, broke the car. And so I unloaded it, I couldn't see any way I could hit him, so I let him come along behind, and I got him what was left of the car, and went down over the hill. Well, I got down, and I thought, well, he'll catch up with me, and I come to his father, and and I had this long flat place, and I hauled it halfway across and sit down. And the horse came around the corner up there and looked down, saw me, and he goes.
Ernest, got any stories about men and horses?
I don't know if I ever really told my father this one, Mark, but he had a mare. Size horse. And every time you go in by it, there's a narrow stall and head went by it to feed her or get her water or something. She'd grab you right over against that wall, you know. And I tell you, if you wasn't quick, she'd catch you. I know my father almost swore at her every time he went by it. I done it a few times. And I thought, well, if I sharpened off a stick and held it in front of me against the wall and she leaned against that, she'd give up pretty easy. She didn't give up easy. I thought she was going to poke the stick off when she came out. But the next time my father went in, he walked right by her. She never came there to it. I think I finally told him what I'd done, but it was a long time before I told him. He never knew what really happened to that horse.
Tom,
you got
any
stories? I don't have any horses stories, but I don't have men's stories. I worked with Billy Hammond. He was working our skill. We lived in the same camp. He'd get up early in the morning and go breakfast, and he'd come back and open the laundry for people. Every once in a while, Bill would take a fit. He'd decide he had to make out the Holland Report. Well, the Holland Report was pretty near as big as this table. And he'd let him go for 3 or 4 months. And he'd decide he'd have to get them all done, so he'd work all night, 24 hours, right around the clock. About the second morning, I woke up, and he said, "You better come help me find these 3 pennies." It's been about 5 minutes, and we had a 3 pennies. Everything, what it did was kept track of everything, what it cost to feed horses and men and run the camp. You had to make it down.
Dick?
Well, this might be interesting about somebody who's working in the woods. Joe Baker, he'd be Romeo Baker's father. He was one of the early, real famous bucksaw men, and that was back in the days before they had the rakers on the bucksaw. They had the old V2 bucksaw. So he used to make his blades out of graphone string and tell.
Avery?
I still have the bucksaw that I used in the 30s. made one trip, but it was quite a circus. They didn't one would hit the collar and the other would have gone back to the bridging, but they finally decided they'd both better hit the collar at the same time after a while. I didn't quite an education, because when I got him to Holland, though, with the best team in the woods I ever drove on Steve Brown, he was good enough, put him off the feet. I don't care, he was right at the end of a stump road on Steve Brown, 3 feet. 3 feet of snow, both the loads right on and right down through. All right down through, they never bothered him a bit.
His patience paid off.
Well, but you could never trust them, you know what I'm saying.
Okay, let's see. Let's move on then to oxen. Anybody had any experience with oxen in the woods? Anybody had any experience with oxen?
Dakota.
Dakota, you had oxen?
I even had Terry Grove on some of Farman Road. But 36 and 37, Albert Skillen had four oxen. They had a pair of Red Devon oxen and a pair of 3-year-old steers. Up to Grafton, up head to Slip Cambridge. And he took some wood to haul over across the ravine. A little bit handier to the landing. He landed on the same landing, but a little bit handier than land up to the horses haul. There was more wood than he could haul, so they had some horses hauling on the same road. And neither yoke of oxen would weigh as much as the horses. One pair of horses, but where you come up, you had to build quite a bridge to get across the ravine. You get off the bridge, it's pretty hard up bridge for the ways. You had to make a swing at the end of it. And he could get up around there with a bigger load with that pair of steers and oxen than any of them horses would. Then, after he semi-retired, had some pretty big Holstein oxen. He decided to be kind of nice to twitch with a single off. Nobody else had ever tried to do it. So he made both a bow yoke and a head yoke, and he made himself a harness to hold your tuck up like you would with the horse, and to hoop around the horse's tail and straps. He was a whiffletree just like he was a horse, and was quite successful.
When I was a kid, we never had any oxen. My brother and I used to have steers around home all the time. Dad had a few oxen that I can't remember as ever used in the woods. But when the snow got deep, it was our job to go up with the steers and drive them around where the road was going, because they wouldn't step on their feet and cock themselves like the horses would with the sharp hind feet. They'd overreach every once in a while, and we'd go break those. Speaking of Skillens, Charlie Higley moved up to Newry. Do some logging, and he bought him a big pair of oxen over to Andover somewhere, and he had to get Mr. Skillens to come up and show him how to put the yoke on.
He kept them in our barn, logged on logs down below there, and he didn't get wood enough, but man had one good horse to twitch it all in the weekend.
They ran away from him one day where he lived up there over across the river, and I was talking to him. He said, "What am I going to do to keep them oxen from running away?" I said, "Just hit your bigger tree on them." Well, he ever did.
Charlie used a snare like you used with a skidder, and he had a long chain. And I got home out of the, I was working in Echo, got home, and I said, "Timmy, let's go down and see how Charlie's doing." So we went down. Met Charlie coming, said, "What's the matter, Charlie?" And he said, "I'm up against the stump. I got to go get a saw to cut the stump off." So I said, "Timmy, come on, let's go in." So I went in, got a stick, backed the oxen up, put a roll on the log, rolled it out behind the stump, hit it a little near the oxen. When Charlie came back with the saw, I was coming with a twig.
Anybody got any experiences about camp life that they want to tell? Log camp. Experiences of living in log camp?
Yes, I don't mind.
They didn't allow any talking at the meal table, and you got a story, have you?
Well, in fact, let's see the stump camp across the river there. As I said, the evenings were long, you know. And
right here in Bethel, down on the middle interval road, right down where, just this side of Richard Davis's house. It stood there by the pond, and after they had the big fire that burned all the lumber and the house, and it burnt this tree too. And so Davis had Charlie Gorman and I passed us a 5-foot crossbow saw and told us to cut that tree one day. And the way we done it, it was, you could hardly get any, you have to get in with a way, you could hardly move the saw, you know. And so what we done is we put in a big notch, and then we cut the sides. We cut in on the sides as fast as we could. Then we take out the middle, and when you got in to where it was too big, we took the handle off one end and put both on the other end and worked the saw right from one end. We got it down, and they sawed it in the mill, and that lumber was, they paneled that that office that Davis had down there that was in there for a long time. I don't know whatever happened to that that building that was there. There was a building that I think they sold it to somebody, but I think the building is still around somewhere, but I don't know where it went to.
Yeah.
But that, that was the biggest tree I ever had anything to do with. But I understand that the last year, a year before last, that they cut a big pine up on the Mason farm up here in Gilead, that the butt logs gave a little over 2,000 for it, but it wasn't cut with a
I believe that that box that 1,100 feet was only 14 foot length long.
Well,
cut that
be,
yeah, you cut
14
that,
feet long.
It 14
but,
foot log.
It shows the log here. It's not the. It also shows it on the carriage here. They're taking the slab off. And by the way,
once or twice during the winter season, well, maybe a couple of the fellows, a couple of preachers who come into the camp, they were, I don't know what denomination they were, and the camps where I worked, there was always a couple spare bunks in the bar room, and these fellows would come in and preach to them, or preach to the men that, or tell stories or whatever they might want to do, and quite often they'd bring a fiddle with them or tell stories or sing. And I really don't know, I don't know where they were from, but they come in a couple times, a couple, three times in winter, and I always heard them called the swamp singers, because that's what they were. It's an old term that a lot of the fellows that were there weren't too religious, I guess, and didn't give a damn what they were talking about, but it took up the evening.
I see.
Reverend Frank Reed, I wrote a book, Sky Pilot. He is the gentleman that originated the Logging Camp Blues, and ended up being the from the time I was a sophomore in high school until I went to college, I got that magazine every time it was put out, 3-4 times a year. So I had a pretty good idea, and it went from here all the way across to New York. So I had a pretty good idea who the bosses were, and the scalers, and the straw bosses, and the feeders, and the cooks, and every camp in the North Country.
I got a couple of comments.
Oh, yeah.
When I was in high school, that was the first time they started taking hardwood for pulp. At the keel, you know. And still an old fella, he knocked a tree, another fella and I would saw him down across the saw and never peel him. But my Uncle Lawrence came up and he never seen anything in the woods. And he watched old Bob Farrow knock the tree. And he says, "Can I knock one?" "Oh, yeah, go ahead," he says. He said, "So he chopped, and he chopped, and he chopped it." "How's that good, Bubba?" "Why don't you hit a couple of knives on the back, then we'll know." Then he saw him chopping down the little yellow birch in the road. He says, "I want to, can I chop one down?" He said, "Yeah, go ahead." So we chopped it. Bubba was watching. He said, "Watch out for him, boys. He's going around for the last time."
Anybody else? No, somebody, you got to go. Go ahead. No?
I was just going to ask, how was the pay and how was it compared to other jobs at that time during that era?
What then's that question?
What roughly was the average pay?
I worked on the drive in Grafton about 14 hours a day. We got a boarding room and $1.25 a day.
Yeah.
When I worked in the woods, usually worked on the first crew of pulpwood. We had what we call a three-man crew. It was a person in the
never mentioned, that was a bull cook.
Right.
He was the guy that went around with the lawn engine and always fired up to get cut the wood for the bunkhouse and the rest of them. I had to think of that when I was collecting the wood. Alan's father was sleeping in the office with me, and the bull cook always come in the morning about 4 o'clock and he'd fire up the fire for some wood. I had a can of white gasoline on the desk. And he came in this morning, apparently he forgot to bring his kerosene with him. So he can of gasoline and threw that in. He luckily wasn't standing right in front of it. It went right back by him, right between the two beds, and cleared back to the wall. He was careful after that.
Getting back to the wages, there was you either work for the day or you work for the piece. There was no hourly pay. There was, your hours was from daylight to dark, and that was the day. The normal pay then was, well, if you got $1.50 a day in your board, you was an extra good man. $1 part of the day was pay. And believe it or not, that was good pay, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dick,
do
you have a comment on that, pay?
Well, driving team was one of the better jobs that they paid you for the day, because that was mostly piecework, too, when you come home in the wintertime, but there was some day jobs. Used to get $2 a day in the bullet, so that was a pretty good job.
That includes your team?
No, I don't just, you were working for somebody else.
Yeah.
If you had your own horses, they paid $2 a day for them and fed them, and $2 for you driving them. That was in the late part of the 30s.
When you were driving the company team, you had to take care of the horses. You fed them?
Some camps.
Well, most of them had to feed them.
Some camps had feeders that fed them, but you had to harness them.
They had breakfast 5:30, so you had to get up and get out then, clean them off, and harness them, and lug the water and water them before breakfast. And then you got your breakfast, and you say they didn't tie up for too many stormy days.
No questions, you got all the answers. The history books would tell us about during the Depression, which you folks are talking about, and a lot of these people that were out of work, such as in Bangor, Waterville, Portland, all those places, a whole ton of them, you know, went right to the woods, went to the companies, and that was the one place that they would have a place to sleep, however bad it was, and they could eat beans 3 times a day, 7 days a week, but they would work for what you said, $1 a day, or just for the food and the clothes, and that's well recorded in our forest history books. One comment that I wanted to make, you talked about bed bugs in the camps, but right immediately after the war, one of my jobs when I worked for a company out of Waterville, working on Jackman, we went into one of the logging camps that's up in Long Pond near Jackman, and I was really a model of shock because as these fellows will tell you, they were two bunks, but they were long bunks, and they would be a stove in the middle, and they would be camps for somewhere between 24 and 32 persons. But if you can picture a top bunk, for example, 8 people sleep there, and there's one horse blanket covers the whole people. And you talk about bed bugs, but that must have been pretty gamey come April.
You see bunks like that after you load them up and go in the woods?
Pardon?
You said you see bunks like that?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Never was anything like that in the woods after I went. That
was during the war. After the war, you were required by the, whatever you call it today, the health and sanitation, you had to get every guy so much breathing space. The prisoners of war that came over here, they lived like kings. They had flush toilets and lights, and each had two men to a berth booth and stuff like that.
See, when I first went in,
$20, and I said, don't you watch? And he said, well, I get to have some money, so I gave him the $20, and I said, when you come back, I have, he always carried a little flannel bag, and I've still got it. He's never been back to get his watch for $20. That's how much money they make.
The other thing is on cleanliness, is that when you guys went in the woods there all winter, you put your long johns on in the fall, is it true you kept them right on until April?
No, we used to boil the lights out of them once in a while.
You turn them inside out every week.
Could you like it?
Elmo, you got a question?
Mayor Rumford was a center, because I can remember when I was a small boy, my grandmother worked in the post office, and she'd take me for a walk on a sunny spring day when you could smell the spruce all over that valley. And the lumberjacks had just come out of the woods. They had the, I call them the pointed hats like the state troopers wear, many of them did with their high leather boots. But I remember my father had a 1934 Chevrolet, my grandmother with my brother on one side and myself on the other. We sat in the back seat, and we ended up on River Street. It was so crowded when everybody was in shopping that you couldn't find a place. So we ended up on River Street, right across from about three or four bars. And the lumberjacks came out there, and the ladies of the evening were loose there. I don't know whether any of you fellows have any memories of that, but were you involved?
Well, I'll tell it.
of what it was all about, that every evening was, so it was a tremendous
Monday call.